Hey there, today I want to talk about the chromatic scale, why we should practice it, and how we should practice it. And to help me do that, I have three of my most intense books here. This is Fundamentals of Guitar with Miles Okazaki. I have covered that book a little bit before, and of course our favorite Thesaurus of Scales and Melodic Patterns by Nicholas Sluninsky, and also Jazz Line by Jerry Bregonzi. Jazz Line. So those three books talk a little bit about the chromatic scale, so I'm gonna dive right into it, so let's go. So in this book, Fundamentals of Guitar, Miles Okazaki talks a little bit about the chromatic scale. So this is a great technique exercise, obviously. We tend to play chromatic scales when we practice speed or picking, alternate picking. So alternate picking, we could play the chromatic scale from A, like this. Scale, so four notes per string. But we're gonna do this. Four notes, then five notes on the next string. So I'm sliding the index finger. Except here, but I don't have to because of how the guitar is tuned, right? Sliding the index finger. So I'm staying in the fifth position, right? And with slide, I mean moving the finger. I'm not doing like that. I'm picking every note, alternate picking. You make sure that you actually do alternate picking. You don't always have to do alternate picking, but it's a good idea to know that you actually can do alternate picking, I think. Gonna play them as sextuplets. So we take a metronome and we set it to a tempo that we can manage. So this is 70. So sextuplets. By the way, a side note here, I was at a workshop the other day where the guitarist was talking about he holds his hand like that. So grabbing the guitar like that, whereas some people say you should be doing this like a classical guitar player. Which one do you do? Let me know in the comments. Do you do this or do you do more of a Jimi Hendrix kind of? Because I always thought that it was supposed to do like the classical technique, but watching him play made me think like maybe I should do more of this, because it gives you kind of support. Some people say that you shouldn't rest your hand against the guitar neck like that. The classical guitar, I think the idea is that you're supposed to leave some space here. But watching some players, they obviously do that, right? So I don't know what your thoughts are on that, but I'm beginning to kind of question my dogmatic ideas from before. Plus it looks cooler. So that's a great technique exercise, just playing not super fast, but kind of a tempo that is that you can manage. Make sure that you're playing it evenly and all that. So here's the problem with this. We're accenting every sixth note, right? So which is great, in that we should be able to do that, but if you want to play scales at a really high level, you should be able to play scales without any accents. Like, all the notes should be equal, and that's really hard to do. So one way you could do, one way you could practice to kind of try to achieve that is something he suggests in this book here. He calls this chromatic rotations. And by the way, he does, on the way down, he uses the pinky to slide. I like to use the index finger instead on the way up, as well as descending. And I'll link to the video. There is actually a video of him explaining his Miles Okazaki, so I'll add a link to that video. So what he's suggesting is that you should start on the second note. So instead of starting on A, start on B flat, but play the exact same position that you just did, right? So you go all the way down to the A and start over, and I'll slow it down here a little bit so you can hear it. So you start on, instead of starting on A, I start on B flat. Then you start on B. Sudden all the accents end up in different places. So if you do that and you keep going, and then after a while it starts over, it becomes the same thing, so it gets redundant. But if you do that, you get used to putting the accents in every possible place, meaning that eventually you'll be able to play it without any accents. It should be just like one flowing thing, right? But we also need to be able to do accents and put the accents anywhere. Should it be just like we're, if all you can do is put it on every fourth note or every third or every sixth note, then you're very limited in a way. You want to be able to do all sorts of stuff. So I want to take this idea even further and use even more subdivisions. So this was sextuplets, so why not do quintuplets? Then you need to find a place where it makes sense to kind of stop the scale and go back, the turn around. So quintuplets. Try to accent every fifth note or every seventh note. So let's do septuplets as well while we're at it. So yeah, I should go up to the C sharp for it to make sense. Those were septuplets, and That's a great thing to work on because when you play, if all you're doing is playing 16th notes or triplets, that's not very good. So practicing complex subdivisions forces you to kind of start to feel the time differently, and it opens up your ears so that you can hear the timing more freely, and you can start to kind of stretch and bend the time, as it were. So we need to work on that as well. So here's a little exercise I got from one of my instructors in college. So let's take a chromatic scale and start with a sub four, so 16th notes, and then gradually build up, adding more notes, so quintuplets, sextuplets, septuplets, and so on. I can't remember the names of all the tuplets. What is it? Nontuplets or so you get the idea, and then try to speed up every time, right? So that we need to set the metronome really slow. So I'm going to set it to 30. So this is a great exercise for many reasons. So you start with the 16th notes. There is the 16th notes. Yes, 13 is too hard, but 14. So it's like two septuplets, right? So I'm not executing this superbly right now because you need to kind of practice this all the time, and I don't practice this stuff. But the idea, not to excuse myself or anything, but the idea is not to be precise, even though that's also something you could aim for. But the idea here is to be able to kind of stretch, again, stretch the time so when you're playing, your phrases can kind of go. You can kind of bend the timing in and out. If you listen to John Coltrane, for example, like his phrases are like that. They're not locked into da ba da ba da ba da ba da ba da ba. So in order to be able to do that, you have to kind of practice that stuff. So that's what how that was how you can practice the chromatic scale and to use it as a technique exercise, but also timing exercise, right? Like the exercise I just did will improve your timing and your ability to hear subdivisions and switch between subdivisions. But it's also a great picking exercise. So you're killing several birds with one stone here. Okay? Moving on. How do you get this stuff into your playing? The chromatic scale is a very different scale than other scales because it doesn't create a mode or anything. It's just all the notes, right? So obviously there is music based on the chromatic scale. The most famous piece got to be Flight of the Bumblebee, right? I'm gonna pretend that I know how to play it because it's one of those pieces that is impossible to play. Conceptually, it's a very easy piece of music. It's just chromatic scales up and down, but it is extremely hard to play. Then we have this. So there, you will find the chromatic scale in music. There is a guitar piece called El Colibri, which I think has the chromatic scale. I might be wrong about that. And then you have some jazz fusion, like Chromazone or something by Mike Stern, which is a very chromatic piece. So we want to separate the chromatic scale from chromaticism. So I'm not talking about chromaticism here. That's more how you add chromatic notes to a melody in the kind of bebop. Or, you know, so I'm adding chromatic notes to the key. A good example would be, adding a bunch of chromatic notes there. So that's something else that could be a different, a future video perhaps. Now I'm talking about the chromatic scale. You'll also find it in a lot of Django Reinhardt's music. He loved the chromatic scale. And those early French waltzes, the waltz musette, whatever it's called, if you want to check out some how to use chromatic scales in music. But you can listen to classical music that you can check out Paganini's 24 Capriccios, whatever it's called. So the idea is that if you just play the chromatic scale, it doesn't sound like anything. You have to kind of mix it in with the key that you're in. So one way that could help you do that is to study Paganini and stuff like that, but also bop scales. Because bop scales are scales with adding chromatic notes. So if I play a C major scale, I add the chromatic note between the G and the A, but you could add more. You could play what's called a 10 note bop scale. So I go chromatically from the root to the third. Scale, it's 10 notes is a chromatic scale minus 2 notes, right? And if you want to know how to create 10 note bop scales on every different chord there is, you can get this book. So chapter 13 in this book, Jazz Line by Bergonzi, he covers how to play 10 note bop scales over major chords, minor chords, and dominant chords, and more. So if you practice that, then you will find a way to get more chromatic scales into your playing without losing the key. Because when you play those scales, you still have chord tones on strong beats and passing tones and leading tones on the weak beats, which creates some kind of tonality rather than just playing chromatic stuff. Because that sounds like that's what we do when we get lost. That's the joke, right? Like what a jazz musician does when they're lost, they just start playing chromatic bullshit. That was a lot of stuff on how to use the chromatic scale in your practicing and playing. Let's dig a little bit deeper and talk about this book. So those of you who follow me, you know that I like to talk about how scales, we shouldn't just think of scales as steps of like that. Seconds. You could play a scale, you could play it as thirds. That's a C major scale, 7 notes. But I play it in a different way then. You could even play it like this. That was a C major scale. Played as fifths. So you want to get away from the idea that this is a scale. That's just one way you play scale. The scale is the seven notes. So there are how many combinations? There's so many combinations. And if all you can do is this, when you're playing is not going to be very interesting. I'm talking about improvisation now. If your improvisation is all based on steps rather than the kind of leaps, then your playing is not going to be very interesting. So can we do that with a chromatic scale? Yeah, we can. Does it make sense? From a practical point of view, not really. But I could play the chromatic scale as fifths if I wanted to. There, I actually play the chromatic, there should be 12 notes. Playing fifths, you're playing fourths on the way down, but a fourth down, same thing as a fifth up. I can't go any higher because my instrument doesn't allow me to stack all 12 notes as fifths. I don't even know if you can do that on the piano, but that's the interval I was playing. So it doesn't make any musical sense to do that perhaps, but it's a good thing to kind of work on this stuff because it makes you more aware of the syntax, is that the word, of music, the how the notes relate to each other and all that. Another thing that happens that if you work on this kind of stuff a lot, like the Slominski book, when you then pick up a C major scale, it becomes easy because you're used to thinking about much more complex stuff. So that's a good thing. I just want to touch on some stuff at the end, or not, I don't know, page 173. Page 173 in the book, Slominski's Thesaurus of Scales and Patterns, is something called 12-tone patterns. So now you're saying, oh, I see, 12-tone music. It's the chromatic scale. 12-tone music, like the Schoenberg and that stuff, is way more than just the idea of using 12 tones. Some people say, well, that's just, you use all the 12 tones of the chromatic scale and you can't repeat a note until you play the next. You have to use all the notes before the phrase to be completed, but there's way more than to it than that. Otherwise, this could be a 12-tone row. That's not a 12-tone row, even though it is all the notes from the chromatic scale. Whatever. So, page 173, there are a bunch of 12-tone patterns. For example, he plays thirds. And then it skips an octave. So you go down there, instead of playing the G up here, play it down there. And then same thing from F sharp. The chromatic scale, but played in a very different way. And then there's a retrograde, meaning you play the whole thing backwards. Notice that the first thing is a major 7, sharp 5, sharp 9 arpeggio. It's a C major 7, sharp 5, sharp 9, and an F sharp major 7, sharp 5, sharp 9 arpeggio pattern. So that's pretty complicated stuff. He also does later here fourths. That's 12 tone row, if you will. So it's a fifths. Scale. So it's not 12 tone music, but there are 12 tone patterns. So 12 tone music did influence jazz a little bit. I think Dave Douglas has done some 12 tone stuff, and Bill Evans has a 12 tone tune. It's called 12 tone tune, I think. So you might want to check that out and check out some music of Schoenberg and see if you can stand 5 minutes of it. So this might be a little bit, how should I put it, ridiculous, you say? Yes, but again, it can spark ideas when you're working this stuff, like, oh, this is a cool sound. So it could be something you could use in your composing. Would you just, as I said before, it's thinking about this stuff makes you realize how kind of all the notes are connected, and also breaking out of the key, because it's easy to get stuck in the kind of major tonality. So anything that can help you break out of that, and this certainly does that. I mean, if you want to really challenge yourself, you take this page in this book, the 12 tone patterns, and you try to sing them. That will challenge you for sure. So that was some ideas on the chromatic scale. I hope that was helpful in some way. So please let me know in the comments. And thank you for your time and attention. I shall see you next time.